Daniel, I gave out, well, I got two of them for some reason. Does anybody need one? I gave out, I grabbed. Everybody get one that wanted one? Okay, all right. We read from Jeremiah 39 how Nebuchadnezzar besieged Jerusalem and Judah, or Jerusalem in particular, and eventually he took it, just as Jeremiah said he would. And then they were all taken back to Babylon, and they were sorted. Those with great promise were taken to the palace to be prepared. In Esther's day, Esther, she had to be groomed to see the king 3 years. So it was 3 years before she even saw the king. And I'm assuming that Babylon I don't think I gave Miss Anita one. Let me give her one. I'm assuming that would be the case with Nebuchadnezzar, that they would groom them and prepare them to even stand before the king, let alone serving. And so in chapter 1, we saw that they had opportunity to eat from the king's table. The king's meat, we would say that is the best. They were offered the best food, most expensive food, and as far as cost is concerned. When I had a church member that was in the army, and when they took, Saddam Hussein's territory? Anyway, he had 7 palaces, and the servants did not know at which palace he could just show up. So they would prepare his meals as if he was coming. And I'm sure that he did not have a lunch meat sandwich for lunch. You know. But Daniel decided that he did not want the king's meat because it would defile himself. And he purposed in his heart not to defile himself with the king's meat. And he went through, and the head of the eunuch saw that what this pulse, chapter 1, verse 12, that they were eating was actually good for them. And they ordered it for all the people. Chapter 2, we saw all the servants. Chapter 2, we saw the dream and was told concerning this image, that image you see on your front page, that what was, what is, and what is to come. Every kingdom of man has fallen, without exception. Every kingdom of man has fallen. And even though he did not want to tell anyone about the dream or any details of the dream, he expected them to interpret it for him, and of course they couldn't do it. The wise men, the sorcerers, the people of the various arts could not do anything for him. And he was ready to have them killed. And Daniel said, let me go see the king. Chapter number 2 and verse number 25, Daniel is brought before the king in haste. I found a man of the captives, and I bet he can be of help. And sure enough, he is told in verse 31 of the image that you have on the front page. head of gold, chest of silver, loins of brass, legs of iron, and feet iron mixed with clay. And this interpretation meant that these kingdoms would fall, and they did. Every one of them did. The Roman Empire fell to the Ottomans in, I don't remember what AD that was, but they fell to the Ottomans. But every kingdom of man has fallen. Okay? Now, does the United States have a chance at lasting? It'll last as long as the people of the United States realize that God gave us the basis of our Constitution, is based out of Scripture, and is that our worship of God has given us the protection and grace of God, and our favor with Israel has given us blessings, because God promised to bless everyone that blessed them and curse everyone that cursed them. So, relatively, the United States is young. But obviously, she has got some growing to do, doesn't she? Okay. Then we come down to chapter 3 of Daniel. And in the plain of Dura, Nebuchadnezzar erects this image. Now, you remember, he is starting to act pretty much full of himself, and now this image, most Bible students believe that this image head was his. He had it modeled after his. So 90 feet tall, 9 feet wide, that is some statue, isn't it, that they have put up in the plain of Dura. And the order was that everyone, in verse number 4, then the herald cried aloud, "To you it is commanded, O people, nations, and languages, that at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, psaltery, dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar, the king, has set up. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth, shall be the same hour cast in the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, at that time, when all the people heard the sound of the cornet, flute, the harp, the sackbut, psaltery, and all kinds of music, all the people, nations, and languages fell down and worshipped the golden image that Nebuchadnezzar, the king, had set up." All right. Sounds easy enough, doesn't it? Okay. Probably, if you were looking for someone with a massive ego, that would be Nebuchadnezzar at this point, wouldn't you? But in verse number 8, "Wherefore at that time certain Chaldeans came near and accused the Jews. They spake and said to the king, Nebuchadnezzar, O king, live forever." If you notice that throughout the book of Daniel, you will find that salutation in just about everyone who addresses Nebuchadnezzar. "O Nebuchadnezzar, king, O king, live forever." They always have that. "Thou, O king, hath made a decree that every man that shall hear the sound of the cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, shall fall down and worship the golden image. And whoso falleth not down and worshipeth, that he should be cast in the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And there are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy gods. And by the way, you remember that when it's in reference to an idol god, it's always a small g. Okay? It's always a small g. Nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. Now remember when he had the dream and he could not find anyone that could interpret the dream, tell him what it was, and tell him the interpretation thereof. Did he not order all of them killed? Okay? He was a man, had quite a temper, didn't he? So what's going to happen here? Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, do not ye serve my gods, nor worship the golden image which I have set up? Now if ye be ready, and at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, and dulcimer, and all kinds of music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made, well. But if ye worship not, then ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Who is that God? See the big G? Who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Boy, that's brass, isn't it? Such a brazen statement. You know, I have these gods, all right? And who is your God, the Hebrew God, that can deliver you out of my hands? Well, we know who he is, don't we? And soon Nebuchadnezzar will too. Verse 16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. We're not afraid. Right?
People are today.
Pardon?
People are today.
They are today. How firm is our faith, right? How firm is our faith? I think in a day when compromise is the order of the day, people's faith is getting shaken. Which it can do. Our faith can get shaken. Facing a terrible situation, our faith can get shaken. Okay? Because if we start looking at the problem instead of the problem solver, we can get shaken. Okay? Brother Johnston's pastors can get shaken. And get, you know, what am I doing? Why am I doing this? Okay? What do you think? In John chapter 20, Peter makes a statement. He says, I go a fishing. What happened to his faith? Right? I go a fishing. Dear hearts, God has done so many great and wonderful things for us in the past, hasn't he? He's brought us through some bad stuff. And he's always been faithful, hasn't he? So what he has done in the past, does that count for today? It should count for today. Because what we have seen will give us the assurance. If he took care of me then, he'll take care of me now, and he'll take care of me tomorrow. So often we see in the life of Israel, as they're going through the desert, that they're getting aggravated and frustrated and complaining, Moses, you brought us out here to die. Who was it that led them from Egypt a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night, who led them, who brought them to the Jordan, or brought them to the river of Egypt, and split that thing wide open, and then guarded the Egyptians from getting them. They couldn't go no further. Who did that? Okay? Who provided them food in the morning and at night, 6 days a week? God did great things for Israel, didn't he? And yet we come across times when they would say, Moses, you brought us out here to die. Okay? We noticed last Sunday that provocation that Hebrews chapter 3 wrote about was because they are out of water and they're saying, we're gonna die. Okay, and they got angry at Moses. And Moses had a temper. Okay? But God told him, strike the rock, and water will come forth. And did not water come forth enough for them, their animals, their children? I mean, we're talking over 2 million people, okay? God took care of that, didn't he? So, what I'm saying is, let's remember what God has done for us. And we can have great expectation of what he's going to do tomorrow. Because he is faithful. He is faithful. So now that you have been given the proper instruction to bow down and worship this image, and their reply, verse 17, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But notice this, but if not, be it known unto thee, O king, we will not worship thy gods, nor serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Now there you go. Okay? God is able, you know, God can do anything, can he? All things are possible with God. All right? And, but if not, they're saying, if he doesn't, if we end up being tossed in the furnace, we still will not bow to your image. Who was it that stood before the Sanhedrin and said, to obey God rather than men, you judge. But we will not serve, nor will we shut up. Folks, I think we're still yet to see what God can do if we will simply yield to his leading. He is a wonderful God. Now, verse 19, Nebuchadnezzar, full of fury, he has gotten angry, and the form of his visage, V-I-S-A-G-E, is an old English term for face. From a kind face, as these men were serving in his government, now he has turned to an angry face. You know, you remember Mrs. Potato Head, as she was trying to make sure that her husband had what she needed, and say, I packed your mean face, because here's a world you're going to get angry about something. And your happy face, she made sure that he had everything he needed. Well, how quickly Nebuchadnezzar could turn from being a friend to being an enemy. Okay? And his the way he looked at them changed. He was angry against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace 7 times more than it was wrought to be heated. In other words, they were going to heat that thing 7 times above what it was even supposed to be. This thing had, it was like a 3-story type of furnace that they used to kiln bricks. Okay, it was a kiln, is what it was. And it was about 3 stories tall. The bottom, of course, is where they would shove all the wood and start heating it up. The middle part would be where they would place the bricks. The top part was for some that may need a little extra time, and they would shove all that in there. Now, 7 times more than what it should be heated meant that that thing was, it's a wonder it didn't explode, right? Because it was heated far above its capacity. And notice verse 20, and he commanded the mighty, most mighty men that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and to cast them into the burning fiery furnace. And these men were bound with their coats and their hosen and their hats and their other garments, and they were cast in the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Threw them in there. All right. Now, folks, that furnace is way hotter than what it should be. And under normal conditions, that would have been it. But we know, okay, starting with verse 24, that Nebuchadnezzar the king was astonished and rose up in haste and spake and said unto his counselors, did we not cast 3 men bound into the midst of the fire? They answered and said unto the king, true, O king. He answered and said, lo, I see 4 men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have not burned, nor the form of the fourth, and the form of the fourth was like the Son of God. Now, how did he know that? Okay. Now, we know they're going to come out of that furnace unharmed. The servants who were stoking that furnace perished, but they come out unharmed. Okay? Number one, is there ever a time when it's proper for Christians to be involved in civil disobedience? When the laws of man violate the laws of God, we have the right to say, no, we will not agree to that. You know as well as I do that if the government had their opportunity, they would shut down every church in this nation. I remember a time when I was wondering if they were going to try to take away churches' non-tax status. Well, look at all that tax that they could be collecting. And they still could, couldn't they? Okay. And for many churches, they would not survive. Because we know how the government's so understanding about people who get back taxes, right? So is it ever, if the laws of man break the laws of God, we have the right for civil disobedience? And of course, I've been asked a few times, is it ever right for a child to disobey his parents? That question, and a simple answer for that question is, that they should obey their parents until they are an adult and they make their own choice. Under the law, there was no delinquency. Boy could be taken before a judge or a synagogue And there he could be condemned to death and stoned. I've often wondered, you know, Jacob, didn't Jacob realize those boys were going to do something terrible? Never entered his mind because it just was not done. You know, you always obeyed your parents. And isn't there somewhere in there where it says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right? Okay? But civil disobedience. And of course, we do have to admire, number two, we have to admire the faith of these men facing possible death, and yet they chose to stand their ground in their beliefs. That is not the first time that's ever happened. Throughout church history, people have stood for what they believed even under the threat of death. I had a nun call me at the office, not here, but somewhere else, inviting me to an interfaith worship service they were having. It's going to be very lovely. I said, do you know you've called a Baptist church? She was just went silent. Oh my goodness. Well, dear ones, there was a time when the Catholic Church persecuted Christians. And their militant arm of the Catholic Church. And I'm grateful that we are free today. At least for now, right? Okay. So now the furnace. And they survived the furnace. And in fact, everyone was completely amazed that they survived the furnace, including Nebuchadnezzar. We're going to stop there for tonight. You remember someone else pitched Daniel into a den of lions, right? Now remember those lions that they used for this purpose were starved, treated very poorly. So whenever someone dropped in for lunch, they were hungry. But I think Daniel came out okay on that deal, didn't he? And his accusers end up taking his place. All right. Now you have three other papers with that listing the Medo-Persian Empire. The head was Babylon. The next page is the Medo-Persian Empire under Darius. Almost said Darius. You know, don't watch VeggieTales. Okay? Don't watch VeggieTales. But Darius is how his name pronounced. And then, of course, after Darius came Cyrus. And Cyrus gave them permission to go back and rebuild the wall, and Ezra would rebuild the temple under Cyrus. Well, then they would pass off the scene. And then you have the Grecian Empire came up with Alexander the Great. And he conquered by the age of 31. He had conquered all the known world. Can you believe that? And they were under his rule. And he also made roads, which would allow his army to get to various parts of the kingdom, of the empire, faster than over hill and dale. So that's what he was famous for. He did have a son, but they killed him and killed his mother, the boy's mother. And those four generals met and decided to break off the kingdom in fours. And that was their downfall, wasn't it? Because the Romans came along after that and used those nice roads for their armies. And Rome was vicious. They didn't take prisoners. They were vicious. They took slaves, but they wouldn't take prisoners. And they would just go through and just wipe everybody out. Remember when Paul was at Philippi and he said, I'm a Roman citizen. And they said, why didn't you say something? Get out of here. because if that word got back to Rome, they would be coming with an army and they would wipe out that town for him, him being a Roman citizen. I think an American citizen anywhere in the world ought to feel safe knowing that the government will stand with them, right? Okay. Now, the Romans went through the New Testament, of course, a little ways, and the Ottomans came up and took over after that. And there were some others after that. In Israel, when I went to Jerusalem, they had a plaque up of all these empires, including Rome, the Ottomans, there was someone after that. That land has been under someone else's control its entire history, up to 1948, when they were accepted as a nation. May something, 1948. And that was quite a feat too, wasn't it? Stand with me, please.